For more than 1,000 years, devout Christians have walked across northern Spain on a 500-mile pilgrimage called the Camino de Santiago. They're headed to the city of Santiago de Compostela to visit the tomb of St. James, one of Jesus Christ's closest apostles. It's a long and difficult journey, over 2 mountain ranges and across a hot, dry plain. All have suffered. Some have even died. Yet they carry on with faith, perseverance, and conviction in a continuous line that extends back to the Middle Ages. This is the next in line, my dad. He's not your usual pilgrim. He's a cigar-smoking, Maserati-driving, 71-year-old surgeon from New York who's never carried a backpack a day in his life. This trip is very unlike him. He prefers to stay home in his big house on Long Island Sound, surrounded by his 8 children and many grandchildren. He was going to take just his dog, Moses. My mother convinced him to take my brother, Christopher, instead. Chris is an avid outdoorsman and recently back from trekking in the Himalayas. I've decided to go along too. I'm a documentary filmmaker. I'm curious why my dad, a successful, busy man, getting on in years, would suddenly decide to exchange his physical comfort and even risk his life on a grueling religious pilgrimage.
I can't think of a better way to die than on the road to Compostela. Millions have happened since the 10th century. And everybody has to die sometime. I'm not afraid to die on this trip.
I have no idea what I've gotten myself into. As we prepare to land in Spain, I'm pretty anxious about this trip. Dad's not always the easiest person to get along with. Neither Chris nor I have spent such a long period of time with him since we left home years ago.
And we are going there in a different way of the Camino.
We get a lift up into the Pyrenees Mountains where we'll start from a Spanish colleague of my father. I'm concerned Dad won't be able to make it physically. For the past several months, I've been calling him, asking him whether he's been training. He assures me he has, but my 4 sisters tell me it's been half-hearted and that he's bringing a backpack that dates back to the Korean War.
No, exactly. This place here, another one over there. It's kind of...
Yeah, this
where shall we park? Here in the middle.
The Augustinian Monastery must be that.
Must be that one, yeah.
Monastery is over there.
Where the canon is.
He doesn't like to talk about his motivations or feelings. I don't think he's an especially religious person. He goes to church most Sundays, but I don't think he even owns a Bible. We begin our journey in the ancient Spanish village of Roncesvalles. This is the site of a great battle more than 1,200 years ago. Charlemagne, the ruler of northern Europe, was attempting to sweep down into Spain with his army, but he was ambushed by the local Basque people and suffered a severe loss, the worst of his career. Dad loves to talk about empires and war. He's also a colonel in the U.S. Army Reserves.
Show the puppy.
During the next 4 weeks, we plan on walking from Roncesvalles and the border between France and Spain out of the Pyrenees Mountains into the long, hot, dry plains of northern Spain, up into the rugged and steep Galician Mountains, and down into the medieval city of Santiago de Compostela, 487 miles from here.
¿Cuántos, verdad?
Tres.
Tres.
¿Y dónde
la gloria de Dios.
De la gloria, ¿qué es lo mejor para ellos? O sea, esta gente no ha entendido nada.
Yo creo que hoy deberían dormir bien. Hoy deberían dormir bien.
Sí, es que no ha dormido nada.
La cofradía, la parte.
Your
parents.
Your parish in New York.
St. Augustine's. Where's that?
Right in your parish.
Right here.
Right here.
And then.
¿De dónde son ustedes? De Cádiz.
Estos no van a subir a la procesión, ¿eh?
Ya lo veo.
Sí.
Ya lo veo que estos me quieren mantas y salgas.
Stamped at all the places. We were told that there would be a mass in the chapel there for the pilgrims who were about to embark on their trip. So we went to the mass and were very pleasantly surprised to see, first of all, that there were about 30 pilgrims there who were embarking the next day. We expected two or three because we hadn't seen them before. There were five priests saying the mass all together with beautiful singing voices. And then at the end, all of the pilgrims came forward and received the blessing of the priests in five different languages. And it's something we certainly wouldn't have wanted to miss.
Dad could have invited any of his eight children, but he chose Christopher, the second to youngest. He is 28, 13 years younger than me.
Christopher has the time to do it, and Christopher has a very strong history of climbing and hiking and so forth. I don't know what his reasons were, but he certainly didn't have to have his arm twisted.
Dad and Chris had a very rocky relationship when Chris was a teenager. And I think Dad may also be trying to patch things up. Dad has decided that we will walk 20 miles a day. He's based this figure on the number of miles General William T. Sherman and his men marched each day as they pillaged the South during the Civil War. Within the first couple of miles, Dad's forced march begins to take its toll. He's struggling badly, weaving across the road and leaning heavily to one side. I think that ancient army pack of his has done something to his back. So we take off the pack and strap it onto the top of Chris's, and we continue on.
I had a army officer's pack from my service during the Persian Gulf, at which time I had volunteered to run a field hospital. And this appeared to me to be a perfectly good pack. The soldiers had used it since the Korean War, but compared to the modern packs and the way the weight is distributed, this thing was awful, and I soon learned after about 4 miles that I was tilting to one side, developed back spasms, so I was walking like a sidewinder.
At a couple of points, Dad veers towards a steep cliff, and Chris and I grab him and pull him back in the nick of time.
And if it hadn't been for my boys holding me up, I could have fallen off one of the precipitous paths.
There's no way we're going to be able to do this for 500 miles. After only 3 miles, Dad decides to stop for the day. We find a local family willing to put us up for the night. My video camera gives me an excuse to ask Dad about his motivations and feelings, something I wouldn't normally be inclined to do.
I thought that this might be an opportunity, one, to get some exercise and to get in shape, to take a month to do the trip. And also because I felt at this stage in my career, a certain gratitude to God for my health and for the health of my children. Also, one of my grandchildren has developmental problems.
That's Ian, Dad's eighth grandchild. He was born last year with a rare genetic abnormality. At the point when most children start walking, Ian still cannot even roll himself over. He has practically no muscle tone. Dad has used all of his medical contacts to get Ian the best medical expertise in the world, and yet no one has any idea what's wrong with him or how to help. No one gives Ian any chance of ever walking.
And I thought that this might be an opportunity to see whether or not there could be divine intercession in helping him develop normally. Not that I expect little Ian will immediately bounce back and start racing around, but I do believe that something could happen.
Did I hear right? My father, a rational man of science and medicine, has come to Spain seeking a miracle? I had trouble sleeping last night. Now I understand Dad's resolve. He's used to fixing people with scalpels and sutures, but all his medical knowledge and skill is useless for someone he cares about so much. It may be subconscious, but I think he has come to walk 2 million steps so that Ian can learn to take just one. Today, Chris agrees to carry Dad's pack from the start. I don't tell Dad this, but last night Christopher told me he doesn't think he's going to stay for the whole trip. It may be a moot point. I don't see how Dad will possibly be able to make this.
Seems like it's more uphill than downhill.
We have gone up goat trails across great hills, mountains, through very, very thick mud, where the mud on your shoes weighed more than the shoes did. And this has been very difficult, not only for me, but of course, Gino and Chris have had to carry my pack a good percentage of the time and most of my gear all of the time. So that this was not something for me to do without my bosom buddy sons along.
Go down here.
I think it's only another 3 kilometers or more.
All uphill.
It's been a long day on the Camino, but we finally arrive in Larrasonia, 2 days and 16 miles into our trip. In Dad's original plan, we would have walked 40 miles by now. We're searching for the Pilgrim's Hostel, where we plan to stay the night. Dad would rather stay in a hotel, but I tell him I'd like to interview some of the other pilgrims. At the hostel, the manager is there to greet us. He's also the mayor of the town. He says he has walked the Camino several times himself. Dad's not thrilled about staying here. It's clean enough, but the sleeping quarters are cramped, and he particularly doesn't like the co-ed bathrooms. But he agrees for tonight. Out back, I meet Maxine Cross, who is walking the Camino by herself. 2 days ago, she became a believer in miracles while crossing over the high mountain pass from France to Spain. It was growing dark. She was still far from town when she was suddenly overcome by a ferocious thunderstorm.
So it seems like every time I got to a point where I need some help. There was someone there. It was just, it couldn't have been coincidence. It was just like someone was watching over me. I made it down through the rain and the lightning. I made it up into a gate that was about 3 feet off the ground. I couldn't figure out how I was going to get through that. And all of a sudden, someone came along and gave me a boost.
Definitely clearing up.
I think it's starting to rain again.
Where?
It's drizzling.
I was taken aback when Dad told me he had come to ask St. James for a miracle. Now he hits us with another surprise. He asks us to take a solemn oath. He wants Chris and me to promise that if he drops dead on the Camino, that we'll ship his body home in a box and finish the pilgrimage without him.
The purpose of the trip was for some of us to complete it. I'm not afraid to die on this trip.
That's crazy. Is he really willing to continue on until he drops? Now seems like a distinct possibility. After wandering around lost in the rain, we finally arrived in Pamplona, Hemingway's favorite city. This is the place where they hold the famous Running of the Bulls each summer. After last night's adventure in the hostel, Dad was right. It was very hard to get a good night's rest there. Dad wants to stay someplace nice tonight. To me, this violates the spirit of the Camino, but Chris and Dad don't care. Chris and I wait outside with the gear. One wet and muddy pilgrim will be shocking enough. We're in luck. They have a room.
Yes.
Charlemagne stayed in fancy hotels, you think?
I'm sure he had them built.
Must have been that detour he took.
It wasn't a detour.
It's on purpose.
We try to find the best hotels to stay at, always looking forward to a hot bath at the end of the trek. I've had great problems carrying a pack for the first time in my entire life. I never even carried a pack in the Army because it's considered infra-dig for colonels to carry packs.
The next morning, Dad buys a nice new pack and a raincoat. Then he heads to the hostel to donate his old ones.
Sí.
Quiero entrar.
¿Para? ¿A qué quiere usted entrar aquí? Ahora estamos limpiando, ¿eh?
Sí.
Estamos limpiando. No se puede entrar hasta la una.
No. I have to leave something there.
Le digo que no se puede entrar.
Sí.
Porque estamos limpiando.
All set.
He just leaves his old pack by the door. Good luck to anyone who takes that ratty thing. The trail is steep and muddy from yesterday's heavy rain, but he seems to be doing better with his new pack.
My father was a man of great dignity, and he taught me a great deal about maintaining your fundamental principles no matter what. He was not a very affectionate man, but neither am I. We stick to our principles, and that I learned primarily from him.
I wouldn't have put you money on you making this 2 days ago.
Oh, 2 days ago, I wouldn't have made it. I feel good now.
I don't think anybody will ever know whether he really ever was transported in 7 days in a stone boat all the way from the Holy Land to the northern tip of Spain. But I don't think it really matters. I think the faith of millions who did believe and who created the legend of Santiago and so forth, I think that's what's important in terms of those of us today who want to take the trip.
What would you consider your greatest accomplishments in life?
Successfully raising 8 children. By successful, I mean that none of them are in jail, and that is considered expert parenthood these days.
And I wasn't even mentioned, and I wanted to cry, you know? Hey, I walk all the way down, and I haven't been even mentioned.
At lunch, we meet Eduardo from Mexico. This is his second time walking the Camino. He's upset that when he got to Santiago de Compostela the first time, they didn't mention his name at the Pilgrim's Mass.
I won't make the same mistake.
So what is the most important thing that you get?
You will find yourself.
Mm-hmm. Just by the time on the road, thinking alone?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. But you will find it 3-4 months after you finish the Sanjak's way. You will find who you are and what the Camino left you.
Knowing that over the past centuries, millions of pilgrims have done it under much worse circumstances than we're doing it, with the faith that getting there means something very serious. And it has a religious connotation. Not that everybody believes that Santiago did the things that he was said to have done, but just the faith of all the rest of them sort of carries you along. You know, it's like saying 50 million Frenchmen can't be wrong. Well, hundreds of millions of peregrinos can't be wrong.
Take a rest.
Nice little start to the morning.
You can get your pilgrim's passport stamped almost anywhere along the Camino, at restaurants, hotels, and even bars. But Dad hears the local monastery has a stamp, and he decides to go out of his way to find it. He figures it'll be more official.
Yeah. Muchas gracias.
You okay?
Yep.
I'm kind of red.
Yeah.
The weather is starting to get hot, with little cloud cover.
Thank you.
okay?
The Camino has some very treacherous sections.
Why don't you take off your pack and do it?
He tries to climb a steep embankment. Halfway up, he realizes he can't make it and tries to turn around. He slips and tumbles all the way to the street and just misses falling into a deep pit filled with water. If he'd fallen in there, he would have drowned.
Yesterday was a miserable day. No rain, no clouds, nothing but sun and hills. And we learned a number of things, and that was that we needed a layoff day today. And I'm sitting here now in the very nice Hotel Arachi, 4 kilometers outside of Estella, the beautiful town that James Michener wrote so lovingly about. But we raced through there in order to get to this very nice Hotel Arachi, 4 kilometers outside of Estella. And I'm now looking at a beautiful view of the escarpment of the Cordillera Cantabria, the mountains to the north of the Pilgrim's route. And we have had a very nice meal, and I'm ready to doze off and take a nap at this point.
We've heard rumors from other pilgrims that near here there's a fountain that dispenses an eternal supply of wine. This sounds like a miracle to me, so we set out to find it.
Von wo ist la Köln?
In Deutschland, Colonia.
Colonia.
16th.
Am
29. April
haben wir angefangen.
Ist nichts.
1500.
Da kommen wir raus. Nur Ätchen.
Nadi?
No. Oh no. No wine. It's all out.
I thought this was the eternal fountain.
We came all this way. There's no wine.
Disappointed peregrinos heading back to the hotel. Dad seems re-energized by his stay at the Hotel Arachi, and the next morning we head out bright and early.
How are you feeling this morning?
All right.
Nice and cool.
Yep.
Who would you say was your greatest influence?
Probably my mother, who was a very unique character, as everybody who knew her would agree. She was a person who came to the United States from Italy at the age of about 9 and really made remarkable accomplishments as a fashion designer and a person who really liked the best of things, was a magnificent cook, devoted grandmother to all of her children.
How do you know that God exists?
There is a great deal of scientific proof of the existence of God. And more we're beginning to understand that somebody had to do the Big Bang. I mean, the Big Bang just didn't happen by accident. And anybody who's read Stephen Hawking's book on the meaning of time and so forth and singularities knows that there may have been something that has done it, and the scientific foundation is there. Plus the fact that, from what I know of statistics, there is no way that the magnificence of, say, the human body or even a fly could have happened by chance, even in a billion years. There are just too many things that had to go right.
Tired?
No, I'm not tired. It's just a damn hip.
You're leaning in the opposite direction today.
Well, I'm trying to stay off the damned right hip, you know. Never had trouble with it before.
Camino's not easy.
Nope.
It's no walk in the park.
Dad's not the only senior citizen on the Camino. We meet plenty of others, including Dick Chase from Vancouver, Canada. He's just 4 years younger than Dad.
Well, my name is Richard Chase. I was born in Perth, Australia in 1933. I retired a year and a half ago, and my brother died in November suddenly, and so it seemed to be a time when I would like to take the opportunity to do something I wanted to do.
Father seems to be in a bit of pain. Has he been like this before, or is it just today?
No, he's been like this every day.
Has he? Got a lot of courage.
You know, see if you can adjust this thing. It does feel as though the pack is lopsided.
This strap. Are these straps tight?
I don't know.
Do they feel tight?
They do tighten not that tight one
enough. I'll loosen this one. Okay. Now try walking like that. Does it feel like it's better?
I think so.
Let me give it one more tug on the right.
Definitely. Que fui lo que tú eres, tú serás lo que yo soy. I once was what you are, you will be what I am now. In the ground.
Dad has a surgeon's sense of humor. Extra black. Even though we're now walking across the flat plains, this hot, dry weather is dangerous for him. Chris and I know we've got to try and stop him before he succumbs to heat stroke. But given all his romantic talk about death, I doubt if he'll listen.
Getting hotter.
That hip should start acting up.
I finally tell him that for safety's sake, he's got to stop. To my surprise, he agrees. I'm relieved this pilgrimage is over. Maybe we'll do some sightseeing in Spain, and then take a train to Santiago de Compostela before we head home. I'm sure St. James would understand. All of Dad's hopes and dreams have been dashed, but for some reason he doesn't seem very disappointed. In Santo Domingo de la Calzada, we find a local parador, a kind of luxury hotel in Spain built in historic structures. This one was a hospital for pilgrims.
So that's 10.
In 9 days, we walked less than 90 miles. It would have taken us twice as long to get there at that pace, if we got there at all.
See if you can find in the book where that good road begins. I never saw it written.
To my surprise, Dad has not given up. Instead, he's come up with a new plan. He thinks he's heard that in order to qualify for the official pilgrim certificate, you only have to walk the last 65 miles. So he scans his map for the closest town outside the 65-mile radius, and we'll start again there.
I think it's safer if we go from Dos Cerebros. First of all, it's a named place. Everybody knows it.
It's also at the very peak of the Continental Divide, which means the walking will be mostly downhill. We'll have 2 weeks to walk just 90 miles. Dad's pretty confident he can make it.
Oh, Chris is in pretty good shape, huh? For somebody approaching 30.
I don't know, over the hill. It's all that Coca-Cola and hot dogs.
Dad meets another fellow pilgrim and confides in her his plan to skip ahead.
Oh. Very nice. And that's 40K.
So you're just skipping ahead? Or are you stopping now?
No, I'm just skipping. I still have like 2 months holidays, but I just found out I have a meeting on the first somewhere in Europe, so I'm just gonna skip ahead, do this, and then I'll come back in a little bit.
We were gonna walk 20 miles a day, haha, and finish it in about 25 days, but going up and down hills, we're lucky to make 10 miles a day. And then I got a sore hip and a sore back, and Gino's got blisters. Christopher has a blister, but won't admit it, so that we felt this was the better part of valor to skip the middle part, which is very boring anyway and flat. The trains and buses in Spain are wonderful and very inexpensive.
Dad tells us we've got to get our story straight. He says we need a good excuse for why we didn't walk the whole thing. He suggests we tell people we're like Turkish rug weavers. In every rug they weave, they leave one wrong stitch so as not to offend God. Chris and I tell Dad they leave only one wrong stitch, while we have not walked 70% of the trail. So he comes up with another idea. He says we can walk the hard parts up the steep mountains at the beginning and the end, and skip the boring parts through the flat plains. Chris and I make no promises.
That is beautiful here.
Here we are, the last stagecoach.
Caboose.
We're surprised to bump into our old friend Dick Chase. He's decided to skip ahead too. I wonder if he has an excuse.
When I was waiting for the train at Logroño, and it was raining and it was midnight, and I had to catch a 12:10 train, and I knew that I was going to get to Penferrada at 5 in the morning, and I thought, gee, this is pretty bleak.
We are now at the highest pass on the whole Camino de Santiago. This is Os Cerebreo, which is the little town at the very top of the pass going on towards the Santiago de Compostela. This is going to be our real test. This is the last 90 miles of the trip. The view from up here is incredible, just mountain after mountain. It's quite chilly. We're at about 5,000 or 6,000 feet. And tomorrow morning, we start off again.
One of the greatest miracles of the entire Camino is said to have taken place here. One cold, snowy night centuries ago, The local priest was saying mass in the little chapel here when the wine and bread suddenly transformed itself into the real body and blood of Jesus Christ. Dad has met an Italian who he thinks is absolutely hysterical. He says the man told him in Italian that he has spent more money on this trip in drugstores than he has in restaurants. It's easy to see why. Blisters are a fact of life out here on the Camino, although Dad brags that he has none. He says it's due to his fancy hiking boots. In Samos, Dad rests while Chris and I go to visit one of the oldest monasteries in Spain, originally founded in the 6th century. They must have a great pilgrim stamp.
Bonito, eh? Muy bonito. Otra.
We also find it has some amazing murals. I wish Dad were here to see these. I think he'd really love them. In the mountains here, even though it's mostly downhill, Dad is struggling again. No matter how difficult this is for him, he never complains and shows no sign of wanting to give up.
Run out of water, in the middle of nowhere, the Pellegrinos have hope. They're just around a bend. There's Hotel International.
The Holy Grail. 3 stars. The next morning, Dad decides he's going to send his pack on ahead in a taxi. He says there's no rule that says you have to carry a pack.
La Posada al Puerto Marín. De acuerdo. 2600.
2007.
Chris decides to send his too. We'll follow you the whole way. In our new lightweight capacity, we will pass these Peregrinos in a flash. We will go by many.
I don't even deserve to wear my Peregrino hat today.
Oh, so you're putting it in my pack? Thanks. A number of years ago, you stabbed yourself with a scalpel while operating on a patient with AIDS.
Yeah.
Can you tell me that story?
Well, that was well over 10 years ago when AIDS first came out. And of course, I didn't stab myself with a scalpel. It was with a suture needle. It was my own fault. I couldn't blame it on the resident. But of course, it's a touch and go, and I sweated for... year and a half. And they test you constantly and so forth, and I dodged the bullet. But at that point, I said, why the hell am I driving these goddamn Chevrolets? And I went out and bought myself the biggest damn Maserati that was available, which I have enjoyed ever since.
Where'd you get a Cuban from?
The girl at the bar brought out the fancy box, Monte Cristos. Here comes a wolf. Pedro! Venga! Venga!
Come here, pup.
You didn't like your machine. Somebody must have been mean to me.
You know, Sobrero.
I don't have any.
Was where the great miracle occurred.
Really? I didn't know that.
In a it's one of the most famous miracles of the Camino.
Yeah?
Back in 15th century or so. There was one peasant who lived around there, and there was a church. And the priest was supposed to say mass, even if there was one person in the church. And okay. There was always this one peasant.
Right.
So he had to get out, you know. And there's one tremendous blizzard. Snow was up to here and it was blowing. And the peasant showed up for mass. And the priest was very disgruntled and grumbling and so forth, but he said the mass. The miracle was that the host became the true body and blood of Christ, the real thing. And it was a well-accepted miracle, which is one of the major ones of the whole Camino. And that happened at Osobrero, in one of those little huts.
I read that in the book, heard but it you were doing horse's so mouth. Well that I didn't like to say I'd heard it before.
Dad loves a great story, but he also genuinely seems to believe in miracles.
How were the showers there? Push button?
Oh no.
Good showers?
Brilliant.
One just didn't work at all and the other was perfect. The thing, only thing that put me off was there were women in the room as well as men.
In the bathroom.
So I was a bit uneasy.
Well, yeah, particularly because there were male urinals.
Precisely. So you thought you were
that's cover it. Over while it wasn't.
I was certain I was safe because I saw the urinals and then this lady came. So I was trying to make my towel about 2 feet longer, you know, to try and cover myself. I was a bit shy about that, but they were fine. They didn't care.
No, they don't care. They give you throw away modesty on the Camino.
Are we gonna make it, Dad?
We're gonna make it.
Are we gonna get a taxi tomorrow for the packs?
Nope.
Oh. Pilgrim's calculations. Pathetic attempt figuring out how much further he has to go. Oh my God. If Michael wasn't behind us, I'd swear it was his. Look at these calculations. So how far to Compostela? Or are they adding up the merits of getting there?
Looks like 17 hours.
They've got it down to the number of hours it's gonna take them?
Well, they divided it by 28 hours.
Yeah. Oh my God. 17 hours to go? At what rate?
4 kilometers an hour.
That's our rate. We only have 17 hours to walk? Oh, are you ashamed that we took the train?
Yes.
Truth comes out.
There's no reason to blab it.
You told us it was perfectly justifiable to take the train.
Among ourselves.
T-
To what do you attribute your great success?
My wife, Paula, has raised the 8 children with very little effort on my part. Over the years, she's been totally unflappable. At this very moment, she's very happy that we're on this trek because she had a number of agendas that she wanted to pursue.
I want one of Grandma's nice pizzas. What do you want on it? Just a little regular, not that all that stuff.
Neapolitan.
She only does pure margaritas.
Want to take a break?
Yeah.
In the beginning, Chris was threatening to abandon the trip, but he's still here.
Machine.
Over time, he's loosened up around Dad and seems to feel comfortable making fun of him. To his credit, Dad takes it with good humor.
Now, there's stars and then there's clover leaf.
Well, still you had a star and a clover.
That stupid place.
The rest of them just have clovers.
And I think this is what has kept Chris from leaving.
Find some place.
Geez, he hardly even rested at all, Mr. Burr.
Well, I found out there was 2 stars ahead, and off he goes.
Aquí, traído.
Traído.
Sí.
Ahora, por Toby.
Sí.
Por Toby.
Sí.
Allí, junto a aquella casa, a la derecha.
¿Dónde está el río?
El río.
Sí.
Aquí es raído, no es río, raído.
Ya. Yeah.
Raído aquí.
Aquí.
Allí, por Toby, mira.
At one point, we come to a monument to a modern pilgrim who died on this spot. I'm a bit surprised Dad doesn't seem more moved by this sacrifice. He seems to have gotten over his obsession with dying on the Camino. We've reached the last hostel before Santiago. We'll stay here the night. We all have mixed feelings.
This is the last refugio I'll be in. And I'm looking forward to getting there, but I'm slightly sad that the whole thing's ended.
Is it the sort of thing that you'd come back and do again?
Oh yeah, I wouldn't mind coming back and doing some of it again. I've missed the middle part, so I wouldn't mind doing that. And also there's the Camino Aragonés, which is the south of the one from the Camino Francés, and I wouldn't mind doing that.
I had a corn when I started, and now it's all gone.
The miracle boots.
Here they are.
It's our last day on the Camino. We only have about 10 miles left. I'm looking forward to getting home to my wife and kids. But I'm also a little sad that this time with my dad is coming to an end. Dad is doing well. His
Gunny
strength
Sergeant
and endurance have increased remarkably. Chris no longer has to carry a pack for him.
Wow, Santiago! Look at that!
This is the final climb of the Camino, Mount Joy. From the top, we should be able to see the cathedral spires. Tradition holds that the first pilgrim to see the cathedral is supposed to shout, Mount Joy. And from then on, those traveling with him must call him king.
Who will see the cathedral first?
Are you king for the day?
Forever.
Yeah,
should say TV towers.
Chris and I are here to help Dad complete his quest. But there is also an unspoken competition between Dad and Chris and me. Dad's been the king of the family for so long, but he's getting older and his power declining. At first, Chris and I stick with Dad, so we'll all see the cathedral together. But Chris pulls ahead, and I leave Dad to catch up. I certainly don't want to have to call my little brother king. But Chris is faster and makes it to the top first. Lucky for me, there's a thick fog that obscures the cathedral.
You see it?
See what?
You're supposed to be able to see the cathedral, and you're supposed
to shout,
oh, no. Mount Joy! And then
you
become queen, the first one to see it.
Yeah.
We're not into the competitive
thing. We decided we'd walk up together so that,
you know. We're trying to break the patriarchal pattern.
Where is the cathedral?
Somewhere over there.
Over there somewhere.
Probably behind those trees, I guess, eh?
As we walk into Santiago de Compostela, Dad picks up his pace considerably. Chris and I are tired from our race up Mount Joy. The five-star Parador must be pulling Dad forward like a giant magnet.
Oh, we crossed up here.
Sly Fox has tricked us. He's the first to see the cathedral spire. We're going to have to call him King. At the Pilgrim's Mass, the priest does mention the three American pilgrims. Then we go upstairs to hug St. James and thank him. It's time to apply for our official pilgrim certificate. We're guided to a small office in back of the cathedral.
And then again also there.
Febrero. We're not sure that all the fancy hotels and skipping the middle section hasn't disqualified us, and the official seems highly skeptical.
So, you're Louis, or Chris?
Chris is him. I'm Louis.
Okay.
All on foot.
But then he finally seems satisfied, and he signs our certificates.
Wonderful experience, really was.
I hope.
They carried most of my pack. Good to have two strong sons.
Yeah.
There's only one thing left to do now. Dad descends into the tomb of St. James. And kneeling before his gold sarcophagus, Dad asks that one day little Ian may learn to walk. We may not have been able to walk the whole thing, but at least we tried. And we walked enough to qualify for our certificates. My dad has taught me the power of faith, perseverance, and flexibility. When we got home, Dad had our certificates framed together and hung them in a place of honor. And he gave my sister a tiny pair of hiking boots he bought for Ian in Spain. It's now 10 years later. Ian is 11, and he's learned to walk. If there is such a thing as miracles, I think this must surely qualify.